Malawi, the unknown Africa in the southeast of the continent. A wild country between sea and highlands. A land of contrasts with amazing green mountains and high plateau. But most of all, Lake Malawi. Located near the center of the country is the capital, Lilongwe. It has a mild climate and is close to the river of the same name, with astute Indian businessmen and fine tobacco plantations. Its splendid markets are among the most important meeting places. In the middle of the 1960s, the city acquired a police station and law courts. Next followed a government which was responsible for Blantyre and Zomba. President Banda is highly revered. Each religion is given free rein in this new young city that to date has no real city centre. On our journey north, we visit the Kasungu National Park, which is situated on the western border with Zambia and has only one well-sited lodge. The 2,316 square kilometre park is located on a plateau, a vast, untouched wilderness that's around 1,000 metres above sea level. Surprisingly, there are old iron kilns which the former inhabitants of this region, the Akafulas, constructed some many years ago. An amazing sight in this remote wilderness. The Chewa tribe settled here in 1920. It was an infected tsetse fly area, but later became a forest reserve. Today, it's a national park. In the northern section of the park are large granite hills from which the surrounding landscape can be observed. Between numerous boulders, a tour guide leads visitors to the black rocks on whose protected walls are various cave paintings created by the region's primordial inhabitants. Hunter-gatherers once lived here 16,700 years before the birth of Christ. They sought shelter under rock overhangs and in caves in order to protect themselves from predators. These are impressions of their daily lives. Evidence that this now uninhabited wilderness was once settled by man. The wildlife here is prolific, but unfortunately, few animals can be seen as the park is afflicted by the menace of poachers. There's a wonderful lodge at Lake Lifupa. Our journey continues. Another conservation area. Further north, also in the west of the country and on the border with Zambia, is the 1,000 square kilometer Vwaza Marsh Wildlife Reserve. home to more than 200 elephants who, in small groups, almost every day visit the Kazuni Safari Camp on their way to the lake. Along the lake shore, walking safaris are popular. And to be within a camp so close to the wilderness is a marvelous experience, but mainly for the adventurous. A few sandy pathways lead across the rugged terrain. Kanuzi Lake dominates this landscape of swamps, grass plains and moraine and acacia country, interspersed with small streams and gentle hills. In the Lake Kazuni area, there are many hippos and crocodiles, which, although rarely seen from the shore, can certainly be heard at night. In 1998, 545 hippos were counted here, inhabiting the lake and its 17 small pools. For wildlife observation, motor vehicles are not ideal. In the woodland, there are antelope, waterbuck, and kudu, another area infested by poachers. But the termites pay no heed. Always something happening here. Animals come individually or in groups to drink at the lakeshore. A great place in which to observe the wildlife. The reserve's animals are only rarely threatened by predators. Its lion and leopard populations have been decimated by the natives of the surrounding villages. However, today the reserve is well protected. We travel north. In the northernmost area is the Nkhata Bay National Park. At first glance, the Cichlids Lodge looks like a log cabin village in the Swiss Alps. And it's particularly atmospheric when fires are lit and smoke rises from its chimneys. It's difficult to believe that this is an African wildlife park. Here, both nature and landscape are so different. Measuring 3,134 square kilometres, this is the largest national park in Malawi. It is a wild and untouched highland, which is referred to as the Afro-montane area of Central Africa. A thousand years ago, the Nyika tableland was completely wooded. However, deforestation and fire have gradually destroyed its great forested areas. Nyika means wilderness. But the wilderness here is not made up of dense bush and unpredictable wildlife, but from a landscape that is almost reminiscent of the Scottish Highlands. At 2,000 meters above sea level, there are hardly any trees. Only various ferns, short and resistant grasses, and wild proteas. In the valleys flow small brooks, and the soil is moist and marshy. This national park was inaugurated in 1965, and with its high plateau, grew to the size it is today in 1978. Starting in June, most of its slopes are deliberately burned. At the end of the dry season, the landscape often looks bleak and colourless. When visibility is good, the landscape opens up and the wildlife is easier to spot than in many other parks. The mountain peaks rise to an altitude of 2,600 metres, and the massive high plateau has a harsh climate, with particularly chilly nights. There's a strange timelessness here. For Africa, an unusual silence and emptiness. We leave the park and travel around the east side. An adventurous path leads up to the Livingstone Plateau. Construction of the widely scattered settlement of this small mission town began in 1894. Dr. Laws was forced to abandon his mission on Lake Malawi 20 years after its creation, as malaria claimed a great many lives. He discovered the plateau and had a hospital built here with several houses, a school, and a church. Religious faith has driven dedicated missionaries to help the people of these isolated regions. In true Scottish style, the school's arcades are more like those of a monastery, and there's a clock tower and old post office. In 1903, Dr. Laws built his stone house, and soon the indefatigable doctor had treated more than 10,000 patients. He had little time to enjoy the fantastic views. In the secluded and pristine environment of Livingstonia, nestled on a hillside in the middle of the Brachystegia and Miombo woodlands, Lukwe Eco Camp was built. The scattered huts are built on stilts. The food hut is a modest affair, but the views of Lake Malawi and the Anyika Plateau are breathtaking. Close by and impossible to find without a native guide is the Manchewe waterfall. The descent to its source is steep, mostly rocky, and extremely slippery. The water plunges 80 meters to the depths below. And the view is quite spectacular. Here, the local people once hid from slavers. To explore the third largest lake in East Africa, we begin north of Malawi's eastern coast at Tunduzi Beach in the Chilumba region. Close to the bleak town, the coastline looks like paradise. Fishing nets are laid out to dry on the shore. The young bathe and play on the beach. Out in the hot sun, the local people wash their laundry in the gentle waves of a sandy beach. The route continues further south. Here the men do the fishing, and the women prepare a porridge of maize which is molded and dried in the sun. Further south, nestled between the rocks and the sea, is the Sangiro Sanctuary, one of the few holiday resorts in the north. The chalets located above the small bay have an unobstructed view of the huge lake. A restaurant and bar cling to the rock, leaving only enough room for the tables. And outside, a wonderful sandy beach. The location of the small town of Nkhata Bay is quite spectacular. A large sheltered bay, accessible via a steep slope. Here, small boats transport the local people to various locations so that they can buy and sell, as there are hardly any roads around the lake. A restless, colourful and vibrant harbour town, and the northernmost point which famous explorer Dr. David Livingstone reached on his historic voyage of discovery. It was here that he mistakenly thought he had arrived at the northern end of the lake. In the 18th century, Nkhata Bay was a centre of Arab Swahili slave traders. A little further south is another holiday resort, Chintechi Inn. Here, there's a peaceful, sandy white beach, interspersed with smooth boulders. We experience the expressive Malipenga, a dance of the indigenous menfolk, pure African culture. An emotional group dance with traditional antiphonal singing and the sound of drums, which have a special, almost religious significance. Next morning, as the sun slowly rises, Lake Malawi shines out and earns its nickname, the Lake of Stars. An asphalt road leads along the lake further south. Near Salima at Kambiri Point is the Red Zebra Lodge and the ornamental fish farm of famous biologist Stuart Grant. From here, colourful Malawi Cichlids are exported around the world. At night, when the fish are sleeping and then consume little oxygen, they're placed in small plastic bags and made ready for export. Cichlids, the living jewels of Lake Malawi, are highly sought after among aquatic fish enthusiasts. The brightly coloured males achieve the highest prices. Provided with a good supply of oxygen and a light sedative in the water, once a month, the fish are taken to the airport. Meanwhile, the employees of the Red Zebra Lodge inspect the newly arrived catch and divide them out into separate tanks according to species, size, and sex. Just behind the fish farm is a paddock with cattle that each day supply fresh milk for the locals and guests of the lodge. And a sandy beach offers peace and tranquility. The coastal area near Senga Bay is tranquil and appears to be deserted. In the water and on land are the remains of old boats made of metal, with no one to dispose of them. The golden sandy beach is inviting, but currently devoid of bathers. Close to the beach, a woman draws clear groundwater. Due to the lack of industry at Lake Malawi, one can drink the water here. Quite remote and difficult to reach is the Livingstone Beach Hotel, with several comfortable apartments whose construction is styled in that of the region's circular huts. But next to this unexpected little paradise, reality. The Livingstone Beach of the local people. Framed by Malawi, Tanzania, and Mozambique, Lake Malawi is situated at the heart of Africa, at the southern end of East Africa's Rift Valley. Its depths are home to the greatest diversity of endemic fish on our planet. Diving just off the coast is like being in a gigantic aquarium. Around 1,000 species of dazzling cichlids inhabit the rocky reefs. It's not necessary to dive deep to observe the Malawi cichlids. The most colourful varieties are to be found just below the surface. We travel by speedboat to Cape McClear. Our next destination is the seemingly endless beach of Chembe Village, a fishing village in the north of the Cape McClear Peninsula. Most fishermen are still out on their boats, and the village seems to be deserted. Only in the late afternoon does life return slowly, and the women wash both dishes and laundry in the lake prior to sunset. Next morning, the local diving centre, Frogman Divers, organises a trip to Thumbi Island, a nature reserve. Louis, the diving instructor, knows the most worthwhile diving sites in the vicinity of the reed belt. There are shoals of large cichlids in the open water. The colourful males court the black and white striped females. Both the variety and incredible number of cichlids give the impression that this is a tropical coral reef. And yet, it's actually a freshwater lake. Deep canyons and crevices create a fascinating underwater landscape. And the visibility is beyond all expectations, even for a freshwater lake. Since crocodiles avoid the clear water of the lake, there's nothing to fear. only the limited air supply forces one repeatedly to the surface. Although the fish seem to swim around chaotically, they actually have well-defined territories. A new day provides an opportunity to visit the Rock of Eagles. Each year, eagles nest on the Zimbabwe Rock and are accustomed to visitors. All Malawi cichlids are closely related and originally developed from only two species of immigrant river fish over the course of millions of years. The craggy rock scenery of Lake Malawi was not always below water. Only when the southern section of the East African Rift Valley filled with water did it become home to cichlids. The endless expanse of the 700 meter deep lake still holds many secrets. In the midday heat, most of Chembe's residents relax in cool clay huts. They only foolish tourists go through the village taking photos in the scorching midday sun. Later, all move slowly, and the beach sees some activity. A boat trip with dive master Louis travels to Zimbabwe Rock, again passing by Thumbi Island. But this time, the island will be explored underwater. As with every other island of the lake, Zimbabwe Rock is home to various local subspecies of cichlid. Their shape and colour is different from that of the cichlids in other areas of the lake. In calm water, we travel along the shoreline to the most popular fishing grounds off Cape McClear. The people of Djembe fish close to the coast, as it's dangerous to venture too far out in their log boats. Back in the village, the catch of the day is sorted. As there's no refrigeration, smoking and air drying are the only methods by which to preserve the fish. The fishermen and merchants keep busy day and night, and the fires of the smoke stoves never die down. Nsima and usipa, porridge and sardines, are the daily diet of the Lakeland people. In the center of Djembe, one can sometimes be invited into a family home. On such occasions, a gift is essential. Everywhere cheerful children and women who grind corn and flour. Next day we travel by boat to Mumbo Island. In the depths, strange craters rise from the muddy seabed. Some have a diameter of more than 2 meters and are 1 meter high. They're not volcanoes, but the leks of male cichlids. A few meters from the shore are aquatic plants, an ideal place for cichlids to raise their young. Only guests of the Kayak Africa Lodge have access to the island, which is home to a bird sanctuary. Mumbo Island means Elephant Island, as according to legend, a lone elephant once lived here. Luxury chalets stand on imposing granite formations close to the turquoise-colored water. P picturesque granite boulders protect the shore, and a dry forest of candelabra trees and baobabs surround the chalets on the island. 10 kilometres away is Dombwe Island. Louis has organised the food, drink and cooking gas. Fresh fish is purchased from the fishermen. The marine park is directly in front of the island. The islands are also home to countless colourful lizards who originally came to the island on driftwood. The warden of Dombwe Island has prepared a fire. The freshly caught fish is cooked and eaten by the fire. And from Sunset Rock is the most beautiful sunset. Monkey Bay would probably go unnoticed if it were not for the fact that the only shipyard on Lake Malawi was established in this secluded bay. Here too, fishermen are busy repairing their nets. Next to an almost military-like shipyard, here, old ferries are brought back to life again, each one a minor miracle. The anglers wait for their next trip. On our journey further south, we visit the Mua Mission, one of the most interesting locations of the White Fathers. A Canadian, Father Boucher, developed a mission here. In addition to a school and hospital, a large church was also built. Here is a workshop for artists and craftsmen, and a museum features Malawian art. The museum building is modelled on traditional circular hut construction, and on the external walls, the history of the country is depicted by artistic images. In 1889, the first four Catholic missionaries set foot in Malawi. But they soon left due to the cruelty and bloodthirsty ways of the slave-trading Yao people. However, in 1902, the White Fathers returned and set up this mission. Dedza is the most elevated village in Malawi. In 1987, Charity and Chris Stevens opened the Dedza Pottery. Around 200 people produce pottery here. For practical use and also artistic items that relate to Malawian culture. Visitors are guided through the production facility and are given an explanation of the work that is done here. The craftsmen are very versatile, quick, and offer their creations at a very reasonable price. Fabulous! Chongoni Mountain and its hilly surroundings dominate Malawi's sprawling central plateau. this region has the largest collection of rock paintings in Central Africa. Red and white drawings cover the rocks. The white, mostly mythological animal figures, are up to 1,000 years old. The red-colored ones date back to the Stone Age. Even today, these mysterious locations are important ceremonial sites for the Nyao, a secret society of the Chewa tribe. Although the motifs of both red and white paintings are different, they are culturally interconnected. In 2006, these treasures of mankind were designated by UNESCO as a World Heritage Site. Treasures that were previously only known to the local Chewa people. Mangochi was created as Fort Johnston on the banks of the Shire River in order to combat the slave trade in the country of Yao. In 1903, near the bridge, a clock tower was erected to commemorate Queen Victoria. And the cannon of the patrol ship Gwendolen was also sighted here in her memory. Here too, there were missionaries. But due to the slave trade, the warlike people came under Islamic Arab influence. Soon they dominated the entire south. Even today, mosques highlight the fact that the Yao are still influenced by Islam and live their lives accordingly. Before reaching the Lewonde National Park, an extraordinary village can be visited. The Njovu Cultural Village. Here, all the young villagers seem to be musical, and old traditions are preserved in a poignant way. Expressive mask dancers, fire eaters, and medicine men are an integral part of African culture, even if the music does sound rather modern. But music and dance are part of everyday life and are also an expression of untamed vitality. Most dances are based on spiritual subjects such as the summoning of rain, a good harvest, or averting disaster. Here, women can be seen going about their daily duties. The Lewonde National Park. The mighty Shire River forms a natural border to the west. In the southern section of the park, one of the few camps, Mvu Camp, is situated beside a tranquil lagoon along a riverbank. This is Malawi's most well-known game reserve. Each year, the Shire River makes its own vital contribution to the breeding season. Up until 1962, unrestricted poaching and hunting almost entirely eradicated the wildlife population of this region. In 1969, a game reserve was created, ably assisted by the local Yao chief. In 1973, it was designated as a national park. Here the wildlife is safe and reproduces accordingly. And man offers a helping hand to undo the mistakes of the past. The park can also be explored by jeep. Lazing monkeys can be seen, and various varieties of antelope graze on the riverbank. The Lwande National Park measures 548 square kilometres, which, in addition to much river silt, contains dry savannas and bushland. In between there are baobab trees, giant cacti, candelabrum and miombo trees. At the park's watering holes, groups of animals repeatedly gather to drink. An ideal opportunity to observe the wildlife. The elephant population has increased considerably, and large herds of them travel through the landscape of the park. They're particularly attracted to the waterholes. They quench their thirst, but also use the mud of the riverbank to protect their sensitive skins from the burning hot sun. Where the Shire River flows from Lake Malombe and meets with the park, there is an impressive baobab tree which the natives worship, but also fear. It's well cared for. Further south, we reach the town of Zomba. A striking war memorial was built in honor of the King's African Rifles, the brave men of this region who fought for the British Empire in two world wars. Zomba is still one of the most beautiful cities in Malawi. The slowly crumbling remains of the once charming colonial villas, with their wooden verandas and blossoming gardens, witness the nostalgic charm of this city. Here too, missionaries were active. The winding road to the plateau is well developed. Fresh air, cool mountain forests, and tranquility are the splendid features of the Zomba Plateau, high above the Shire Highlands. In contrast to the lowlands around the lake, it rains here all year round. The evaporated water of Lake Malawi condenses on the slopes of the mountains and nourishes a lush rainforest. The forests on the Zomba Plateau are dependent on regular rainfall, even during the dry season. Since British colonial rule, most of the rainforests in the south of Malawi have been ruthlessly cut down or replaced by timber plantations. Forests of Mexican pine orchards with vigorous growth often transform the landscape into an ecological desert. Primeval forests are found today only along streams and small lakes. Leopards, hyenas, antelope once lived in this mountain area. they were heavily hunted. Between November and March, the monsoons bring moisture from the Indian Ocean. Then there is heavy rainfall almost every day. The farmers use the high plateau mainly for the cultivation of vegetables and trout farming. The view is outstanding. For the Scottish missionaries, Blantyre's climate was ideal. With no knowledge of architecture, Reverend Scott built the St. Michael and All Angels Church. It was built between 1888 and 1891 of red brick and combines a variety of styles. Several buildings with corrugated sheet metal roofing represent the center of the former government city of Nyasaland. Here, it's like time has stood still. The surroundings of Blantyre are known for the cultivation of tea, and endless tea gardens extend along the road. Tea production began in Africa in 1891. After tobacco, tea is the country's second most important export. On the extreme southeast coast, on the border of Mozambique, is Mount Mulanje, a huge mountain range that formed during volcanic activity more than 130 million years ago. At the foot of the mountain scenery grows one of the world's finest varieties of tea. The people here live almost exclusively from work in the tea plantations or from timber production. Missionary gardener Henry Brown planted the first tea bushes here. He could never have guessed how important that would become for Malawi. Malawi teas are strong and full-bodied and are processed in both London and Hamburg. The Mulanje Plateau is situated at around 2,000 meters above sea level, and the highest peak reaches 3,000 meters and is the highest mountain in Central Africa. The best way to discover the beauty of the Mulanje Plateau is to explore it on foot. The peace and solitude of this area is well worth the climb. In 1927, the Mount Mulanje Forest Reserve was established and has been protected ever since. Many wild flowers cover the plateau, with few animals but much bird life. Myths and legends surround the mountain landscape. Little people once lived here, and Napolo, a snake-like creature who brought savage thunderstorms and catastrophic weather. Other myths tell of a human-like figure with a single eye, arm, and leg, flying through the air and making anyone who saw it disappear forever. The silhouette of Mount Mulanje dominates the landscape. experienced climbers visit this mountain region, which is sparsely inhabited. A natural paradise with impressive mountains and wonderful fauna and flora. Thousands of years of history, the slave trade and missionaries have all played their part in forming this country. The Maravi Kingdom eventually became an independent country. Malawi, the warm and beating heart of Africa.